All right, hey everyone. We're gonna get started. Thanks for coming to Hard Earth. Really excited that you guys are here. I know there are a lot of fun things to do on Stanford's campus. And I'm just happy that you're here to like learn a little bit about sustainability and bioengineering this evening. So if you don't know me, my name is Andrew Santos. I coordinate the seminar and I run the class that's associated in which we have discussion sessions that talk about the ideas presented here. And I'm really excited about tonight's talk. Before I introduce our speaker, I just want to say there are plenty of snacks, cookies and grapes, so I'd like to feel free to pass them around. Make sure to eat them all because I don't want to bring them home. And then if you are in the class, could you please sign in on my computer right there? That would just help me out in terms of logistics. And with that, I'm going to introduce Rolando. So come on. Rolando Perez is a PhD student here at Stanford. Rolando did his undergraduate degree at UC Santa Cruz.
Yep.
And now here at Stanford, he's a PhD student in the bioengineering department, which is really cool because to me, so the bioengineering department is co-managed by the School of Engineering and the School of Medicine, which I think sort of embodies the spirit of interdisciplinarity at Stanford. And part of the goals of the Hard Earth series is to sort of demonstrate that those working on sustainability challenges aren't just, you know, your applied physicists working on the next solar cell. It touches lots of disciplines. It's really difficult and interesting work. And so I'm super excited to have Rolando here to share some ideas. And so please join me in welcoming Rolando.
Hello everybody, my name is Rolando. So I'm gonna go quick because I've got lots of cool stuff to talk about, not so much time. Basically, the talk's going to be about bioengineering and applying bioengineering in a way that is holistic, in a way that is in symmetry and congruence with nature. Intervention genetically as a last resort, learning from life, learning the plasticity of life, learning how to coexist with life and the plant. And throughout the talk, I'll present some slides, maybe some provocations for you, and things. If you have a question or a comment in the middle of the talk, go ahead. I prefer to get through the talk because there's so much cool stuff, and then we can talk about it after. I'll stay after and talk if you'd like. But I'm struggling with a good talk. This is my first time presenting this context. I've given talks before, but this is the first time I'm finally here at Stanford doing the work that I want to do, and developing like my culture, my identity, my just becoming a researcher in my own right. And so I'm a big ideas person, teaming up with nature for generations to come. It's a bit cheesy, but it really makes sense to me. And so we'll get into it right away. So the presentation outline, I'm gonna go through it, just a slide about my background, about my motivations, and the background in the research. Then my research, the two different projects that we're working on in the ND group, that's the ND, Drew ND's lab at bioengineering. And then some challenges throughout the talk. And then at the very end, we'll leave it open to some discussion and some dialogue. So I went to community college. I graduated high school in 2002. So you can date me now, 33. And I decided that in high school, I was a bit of a knucklehead. I had a bunch of different kind of paths. I ended up back in community college at the age of 25. And in community college, I went through a bunch of different experiences and found bioengineering. I'm a first generation US citizen, so my parents are immigrants from Mexico. I'm the first person in my family to go to university. And in 2010, I heard about bioengineering. I actually was doing a Google search for an English paper, research paper, and Drew Eddy popped up. And I was like, wow, this is awesome, this is cool, this is really cool, it's like DNA is code, I could write code programs and save the world. And I didn't know at the time that, like, you know, 6 years later, I'd be working with him in a lab. So I had some internships. They really influenced me. So when I first went out to community college, I was like, I'm just going to get a job. I'm going to get out. I'm going to get a car. I'm going to get a house. I'm going to get a family. That's it. Like, I'm going to get a BA, BS, whatever, and that's just my deal. I'm not going to, there's no way I'm going to go to school for 10 years. You're crazy. But, you know, it changed. I did my first internship. I was like, whoa, science, this research stuff is cool. Like, I can do this. Like, it's not all like, Einstein's in the lab. Even Einstein had to learn from somebody. I don't think Einstein was born a genius. That's controversial. Community college experience really imprinted on me the broader motivation for broader impact. A lot of my friends are dead. A lot of my friends are in prison. I come from San Francisco, California. You can see the San Francisco Bay Area at the top of there, and then you have this like nice chunk, Monterey Bay. It's a national sanctuary. The Salinas Valley cuts across down here, goes south. It's one of the most fertile places, I would say, on the planet. We produce $9 billion of agricultural industry out of this small area, this small valley in California. But then our schools are some of the most, the least performing schools, the worst schools in science and math in the country. $9 billion comes out of that place. It's a beautiful place. It's an old place. People have been working the land forever. Immigrants have been coming, Chinese, Filipino, Japanese. We had internment camps in Salinas Valley. Today, there are ICE raids that are going into people's homes and breaking them out. 20 people living in the house, and they take 10 of them at a time. There's a prison. Well, a lot of my friends are housed in that prison. A lot of my high school friends are housed in that prison. That's it. So I go home, I talk to my family, and I look for some friends, and most of them are, you know, dead or in prison. And we talk about broader impact and the ethics of these kinds of technologies. Coming back to Stanford every morning, I talk with Drew Endy. We talk about the impact of bioengineering, the impact of automation, the impact of all these different things that are coming online, how that changes our social compact, how that changes our social contract. And Forbes is now coming to Salinas Valley because everybody knows now that agriculture is going to be making some of the next trillionaires, or speed trillionaires. If you haven't heard, Bill Gates can give away all his money, or try to. Even if he does that, he'll still be a trillionaire in like the next 20 years. How is that possible? And it's an old place. So the Ohlone, the Salinan tribe, the Costanoans, they lived in this place. And I draw, as I try to learn as much as I can from that kind of ancestral lineage, and I try to draw from it. It was a tough time for those people that lived back in that day. We don't try to romanticize it, but because it was tough, they came up with different solutions that may inform ourselves today how to do things given our technology and given our way of life. That's my motivation. So we get right into bioengineering. Whether or not you feel comfortable with it, well, here it is. We've been engineering, I think, well, we've been choosing, shaping life for thousands of years. Look at some of these things. You go to go down the Whole Foods. You're not going to find anything that looks like this, right? Whole Foods is organic. Whole Foods is the place you go when you want stuff that's not GMO, right? Well, there it is.
We really enjoy the ability to take the gene pool and use it like paints. It's our art. This is my art. I made this beautiful dog that I enjoy. I made her. I chose her sire and her dam. I chose several generations to make this beautiful dog. I'm very proud of her.
Also shape environments for the good or for the bad. So I ask you, I provoke you, the rock floating in space, does it really care about what's growing or living on its surface? Is it about the people? Is it about the other living things? Can we live on this planet without the other living things? What is the ideal state of our Earth, of our planet, of our home? Is it some past? Is it some future? Do we have to choose? So engineering biology, what does it mean to engineer biology? I could get into the DNA and RNA and but very simply, what we're trying to do at Stanford or at the bioengineering department in concert with other folks in other departments, because this is a multiple discipline thing, is measure. We want to measure everything. In our lab, we have this thing where, we have this saying where it's like, this is an adaptation of our goals across the department. In our lab, we say we want to measure everything that happens in a cell. We want to know where every atom is inside of a cell and what that atom does. We want to model every cellular process. And we want to make of and with biology. What I mean by with is biology is plastic. Biology already does amazing things. How can we work with biology in a kind of concert way, in a way that we can all, like my advisor says, in a way that we might all flourish together? This is the century of biology. If you haven't heard, then this is where it's at. The next decade, the next few decades, the next century is going to be driven by biotechnology. There will be advances that we can't foresee. Nowadays, people are really getting to understand that for a long time, people would say, well, we tend to underestimate things in the long term and overestimate things, the impact of technologies in the short term. And I sense that, and some people are echoing this kind of mentality, that those things are changing. That now technologies, exponentially driven technologies, artificial intelligence, biotechnology, all these things are just meshing together, and they're having, their ideas are getting together and spawning new ideas, and we can't understand, it's hard to understand the way that these networked technologies are coming together and developing, how they will impact our lives. You can see that biological technologies are just growing exponentially. So, it hasn't been the case that biotechnology has been advancing at the rate that it has. 1979, Genentech, one of the first companies to employ some of the first biotechnologies. They used these things called restriction enzymes, and they know them here. If you could read it, you would see that there's some names there, some names of restriction enzymes. In 1985, the same thing. They were using the same exact enzymes, same technology. And in 2006, the same technologies, the same exact enzymes. So it was static for 27 years. We hadn't seen a lot of advancement. So people would say, oh, you know, my dad would go home and talk to him, and I'd say, Dad, we're going to do this, and these things are happening, it's so crazy. And he's like, yeah, I've heard all that stuff. I heard that stuff back in the day. We're going to have, you know, GMOs and all this and that all over the place, and we're going to live forever. Where's it at? It hasn't happened. And I'm like, okay, well, you know, you got a point. You got kind of a point. Well, as you look to our friends in electrical engineering, they went from designing chips on these things here to very large scale integration, using software and computers to help them design complex systems that were out of the scope of being able to design them on your own. Right? So the level of complexity just is just dwarfing. When you look at electrical engineering compared to the circuits and things that we're building with biotechnology, or were building. So 27 years, things were dynamic, they were changing, they were getting better and better and better. Much of that was driven by Moore's Law. So Moore's Law tells you basically that you can get twice as many transistors on a chip, your computers get faster, twice as fast, and half as cheap every year, right? And that drives technology, that drives the internet, that drives our flying cars, that drives your human interface, machine interfaces, your neural prostheses, and today now synthetic biology. Synthetic biology, the research that I and a couple of my colleagues are embarking on is not possible without Moore's Law, the advances in computers and robotics. That Moore's Law has driven down cost of reading DNA, which is sequencing, the blue line, falling faster than exponentially than Moore's Law, and synthesis, writing DNA. So if you can read DNA and you can write DNA, you might be able to make things, very interesting things together, right? And the yellow line is DNA synthesis, which actually today is like falling even faster. I mean, when I came into the lab, it was like 10 cents a base pair. And now today it's 4 cents a base pair, so it's like dropping even faster than Moore's Law. That was a year ago, sorry. And so we look at what does rewrite allow us to do? Well, if we wanted to engineer an organism, say synthesize a chromosome of this organism, how much would it cost? Well, how feasible is it? Just practically, not that we can know what it does or we can even fathom how to design these things, but can we physically make the DNA? And how much would that cost? Well, if you look at Stanford tuition, the red line, it goes up over time. And you know, $10,000 or $100,000 for Stanford tuition. This orange line here at the bottom is the cost to synthesize an E. coli chromosome. To me, that's important because I look at an E. coli as the most well-understood organism. For many decades, we've been prodding and probing it and trying to understand how E. coli works. It's the bacteria that grows in your gut. It's the people use it in their homes, the kids use it in high school. And we can't make an E. coli. But if we could understand how maybe we can make some chromosomes and build them and test them, we might be able to. And if we can do that in a cost-effective way, in an iterative way, and try to understand how that works, well, pretty soon the cost to make an E. coli chromosome will be cheaper than it is to come to Stanford. And you can imagine that some startup company might take their credit card, or maybe some person might take their credit card and pay the $10,000 to $100,000 to synthesize a chromosome if they designed it and they've done it. And then you go and you synthesize that chromosome, now you've got a company that maybe makes bacteria that eat plastic. I think there's a market for that. What would you do? And so the point here is that these things will become like just trivially cheap over time. And eventually you'll be able to synthesize a human chromosome and a human genome. Some of those lines represent human genomes. And what does that do when you can synthesize a human genome? There's a lot of ethical questions to be discussed. And so if you look at all Homo sapien chromosomes by 2049 would be $30 million. That's a drop in the bucket for some of the venture capitalists up on Sand Hill, right? The bioeconomy, so what does this all do? What is this all for? What is the vision? Why? The bioeconomy. I present to you this idea that the economy we have today, much of it is situated, if you look at a stack of modules from the natural resources of the planet, then us extracting those natural resources, and then on top of that, the economy that's built, all the different things that come from it. Much of it is driven by petroleum, fossil fuels, right? So if you think of that as a module, and we take that module and we pull it out and we replace it with things that are built and made and grown by biology. Biology is wonderful to distribute in nanotechnology. So you can have this closed loop economy where everything that's made, that comes out of it, all the waste, it goes back in, it's recycled, made back into products. I'll show you later how I'm working with fungi who you could potentially feed human waste to and then turn around and eat it for food. Just to reiterate, like, people are on board. UK, US, all these different organizations, they're all taking notice that these technologies, these things that have been going around us, they're going to disrupt economies, they're going to disrupt governments, they're going to disrupt a lot of different things. And if we look at, just for instance, the beer market, you can look, see here we see Prohibition. Prohibition came around and there was no beer brewers. After Prohibition, there were some beer brewers. Most of the beer brewers were centralized. The blue lines are large, centralized beer brewers. The orange lines are microbrewers. So over time, the large beer brewers went down, and the microbrewers went up. Microbrewing is just basically taking yeast from some vats, and you make beer. That same technology, it's the same technology that synthetic biologists might use to ferment medicines. So you could have the same technology you use for beer to then go and synthesize some medicines. In your home or distributed, you won't have to make them in one central place and distribute them at other places. You can have distributed manufacturing where they need it, when they need it. And an ethical question, who is gonna participate in the bioeconomy? Can we enfranchise all life on Earth? And what I mean by enfranchise ethically, and also, who's to say there won't be an internet of living things? These are challenges that I struggle with, that I have a discussion class every Monday. We talk about these kinds of things, and they're important. They're extremely important. Where I came from, people are not enfranchised into those local economies. People are just used as labor. And as we know, those kinds of contracts, those social structures, they're changing. And how will they change, and how will they affect our living, the way that we interact with one another and governments going forward, when you have robots doing these things and people aren't, you don't need a ton of people to drill things and haul things out of the earth. You could just have a bacteria grow billions and billions of cells to produce billions and billions of your whatever, your chemical of interest, your material, whatever it is.
Can I ask a question? Sure. What do you mean the Internet of Living Things? What's that vision?
So you know the Internet of Internet of Things, everything's connected. Whether that's good or bad, people ask us questions. But I'll show you in a bit, fungi that mediate communication between plants. And the plants, the trees actually use the fungi as an internet to communicate. And right. So if we have, and we're developing technologies to now real time interact and investigate living organisms. I suspect that'll only get better. So there may be a time where on your iPhone, you can interact with your dog or interact with the bacteria on your dog. It's the internet of living things. What is the future we're hoping for? Given all this, it can be overwhelming, but what is the future that we might wish for? And one of the reasons that I joined Drew's lab is this vision that I share with him, the BioBridge Foundation, is this vision of people working together with nature, everyone, equity, those kinds of things. Those are the kinds of keywords that we like to emphasize. So, working together, if we're going to emphasize that, what are the ways that we can work together? What's possible when we work together? This cell right here, this is an artist's rendition. It's awesome, it's super cool, but it doesn't even capture, it fails to capture even a slice of the complexity of a cell. Cells are complex. Our tools are getting better. They're getting exponentially better. And people are building very complex systems. But we still see that we're at the forefront. We still see that it's impossible for any one person or group to do this on their own. And we don't think that it's the right approach either. And so we are pushing forward this idea that only together, in a collaborative, coordinated labor effort, can we understand the complexity of cells and engineer them ethically. We take inspiration from our colleagues over in electrical engineering and computer science.
We are trying to make computing as simple as possible. In the late 1960s, Dennis Ritchie and I realized that the then current operating systems were much too complex. We attempted to reverse this trend by building a small, simple operating system on a mini computer.
Well, what we wanted to preserve was not just a good programming environment in which to do programming, but a system around which a community could form fellowship. We knew from experience that the essence of communal computing, as supplied by remote access time-sharing systems, is not just to type programs into a terminal instead of a key punch, but to encourage close communication.
So they had a problem. There was all this complex stuff going on, and people weren't really communicating together well, and it just seems like much of what's happening in our field. Cells are complex. You make you could piece together a couple genes, put it in E. coli, and it does something for a certain amount of time. And then you might want to take that and then put it in a different bacteria that might do something else better. And then you're like, oh, it doesn't work. It's because it's context dependent. And we're trying for the past couple decades to figure out how to do that. People have been working, throwing millions of dollars at it. And people understand that now, well, if you can do something like computer science, have an operating system that you could write a piece of DNA, a code, a program that does some functionality, and have that be able to be seamlessly ported over to other cells, other organisms, that might accelerate the complexity of design of these systems. So we hypothesize that it takes a community to build a cell. And what we mean by build a cell is that we go back to measure, make. We want to measure everything that happens in the cell. We want to model everything that happens in the cell. We want to make a cell from scratch. And so if you look at computers, you say you write a program, and you have some operating system. The operating system interacts with different hardware, the hardware being different computers, different chips, and they go back and forth. So this operating system is central because then it lowers your complexity. You don't have to make all kinds of different intermediate cells or intermediate computers to handle that program. You just have one operating system, handles that program, and it runs on different much like Unix, it can run on different hardware. Well, for biology, if you want program A to run, you have to change program A to something that cell A or cell squared would like. Same thing for all the other cells. You have to change your program constantly. So it's always this like optimization, this changing of the program. It's difficult, it costs money. But if you could build a cell from scratch, a cell that is whose genome is understood and defined, and you know every single base pair in that genome, what it does and why it's there, and you know how all these different individual parts are interacting together in the complex network that is the genome and the cell, then you might be able to have this system that you can predict, that you can work with better to do things. Now, today, when I want to go and take an E. coli that's been engineered to eat plastic and just release it into the environment, I don't think so. I don't know how that's going to interact. But if I had a cell that was more engineered, that I can predict, that I can model better, then you might be able to get to a point where you test it and test it and test it and see how it performs. And so our approach for build a cell is to take two approaches that are currently being tried. One is people take chemicals, they mix them up in a test tube, and it spontaneously forms these nano shells, these particles, and then they randomly encapsulate things like DNA and proteins that hopefully make the cell boot up and start dividing and growing. Other people take cells and they chop out their genomes and they try to whittle it down to the most primitive thing that they have. So we're like, well, those two approaches haven't gotten anywhere in the past decade and a half. What can we do? We started like this, we thought we could do a kind of middle approach, take the best of both worlds, where we would synthesize a chromosome from scratch, we would know everything that's in that genome, and then put it inside of a cell that used to have a genome, and see if it boots up. What we mean by boot up is we literally would take a cell and take its genome out. You would have a shell, and then you would insert, maybe with a virus or some other thing, insert your chromosome, your genome into it. And because the cell has all the extracellular milieu, all the nano machines, as I like to think of them, or proteins inside of it, it might start to boot up, and you might get it to grow and divide. So the day that in our lab, maybe it happens in my time here, but I don't think so, but the day that someone does this and then looks under the microscope at cells that were dead, that didn't have any genome, that did not grow anymore, that stopped, and then they start to grow and divide, that'll be a monumental day, because then that day we'll understand that we have just enough knowledge to help to make cells to grow and divide, and then the future is kind of open. So based on mini cells are these mutants of E. coli. E. coli divides symmetrically usually. This mutant divides asymmetrically, so it'll bud off that little pole right there. That little pole buds off, it has no chromosome in it. And so that's like our starting material, our hard problem, the puzzle. What would you put into a mini cell to reboot it? So this is E. coli growing exponentially. Just takes over the whole slide. If you look closely, you got these little tiny round things that bud off of the E. coli cells. Those are our mini cells. They're nanometers, hundreds of nanometers in diameter, so they're tiny. We're constrained by how much DNA we can put inside, but we like that. It's a challenge, it's a problem. It's a nice puzzle. So here you go. The puncta, the bright puncta, are bright because these mini cells, they don't divide, they don't grow, they don't dilute. And so they're just there. It's static. It's different from biology. The biology is always growing. It's always doing something. These mini cells, they just stay. They just persist. And we think about, you got all this stuff, and you got people wanting to collaborate on these cells. And I mean, can this be safe? Let me tell you, when I started on this path, that English paper I told you about that I wrote, it was a skeptic's paper. I was like, I heard about this stuff. I saw Drew Andy talking about genetic engineering, and I was like, whoa, like, you gotta hold on. Like, this is powerful stuff, and rightfully so. We should be cautious. We should be vigilant about what's happening. But I think it can be done safely. And you look at the DIY bio community. A lot of people call them biohackers. It's like a cool community. You go, and there's a place in Oakland I'm going on Saturday, and they got labs. Anybody can go and learn this stuff, and you can tinker, and you can do this stuff in your garage, but you can also go to these open community labs and do it. And we're developing technologies that will allow us to mitigate risk, because nothing's without risk, right? And it's all about like mitigating risk and what's your risk level and how much risk are you willing to take on.
What's the name of the community lab in Oakland?
Counterculture Labs. It's a really cool place, man. It's really cool. So now I bring you to fungi. Fungi is what I work with, but mostly nowadays. I'm like enamored with fungi. I love fungi. I dream of fungi. It's crazy. So I work with this fungi here, Gamma verrucinum, otherwise known as linkid. The mushroom immortality has been used for thousands of years in ancient Chinese medicine. And you look at the North American side, or the Americas, the Aztecs and other tribes use this one here. We call them magic mushrooms, psilocybin. And it's interesting because, you know, these things were used for different purposes in ancient times, and now today they're coming back, and lo and behold, we're using these things that, you know, back in the day were used for certain purposes, spiritual, whatnot, medicinal, and now today people are using these things again for medicinal purposes. Taking a magic mushroom that makes you hallucinate and helping people with schizophrenia or different other disorders. Mycotechnology is ancient. People have been using mushrooms for different things for thousands and thousands of years. Taking mushrooms and using them for tinder, taking mushrooms and using them for wood dressings, wound dressings, and making clothes out of them. Although I'm not sure how old this is. There's a gentleman in Transylvania, Romania, is making clothes out of mushrooms. I'm not sure if that's a passed on tradition or not, but still interesting. And here we go. The wood wide web. So what I've learned in my time studying mushrooms, working with ecologists in the short past year, is that mushrooms mediate all kinds of interesting things. They are essentially the network of life in the forest. They mediate water and nutrient transfer. They mediate communication amongst plants. They also mediate the turnover of matter in the forest. So they are the primary degraders. Things die, the mushrooms eat them. And then things eat mushrooms. Mushrooms eat mushrooms. It's just this cycle that is like been optimized. So if we look at mushrooms and we think about the bioeconomy, what role can mushrooms play? Well, mushrooms can play this primary degrader role because we need to break down all the waste and put it back in. And mushrooms can be a thing where we feed them plastic and we take the mushroom and then eat it. That's what the design here on the right said. These folks in Europe are hoping to develop mushrooms to eat plastic and then eat the mushroom. Gamma verrucinum, ancient Chinese remedy, produces all kinds of compounds that have been shown to be in test tubes, anti-cancer, anti-tumor, and it's also a wood degrader, one of the best wood degraders that we know. And that's interesting to me because we can take agricultural waste and do things with it, feed it to the mushroom and make stuff out of it. I've also been studying this other mushroom that forms a symbiotic relationship with plants. It forms a cocoon around the roots and lets the plants live when there's a lack of water, when there's high saline solution. And so the plant gives carbohydrates, food in the form of sugars, to the mushroom. And the mushroom mediates water, it finds water for the plant. They form this really close symbiotic relationship. The microstructure that we're interested in, what we're interested in is the mycelial network, the part of the mushroom that lives in the ground that forms these micro meshes that you see right here. That is interesting to us because it forms a micro mesh of material, three-dimensional material, not like bacteria where bacteria grow in some solution or maybe grow a biofilm. This mushroom material can grow three dimensions. And you can make stuff out of it. Potentially these things that are hazardous to our health that we put into our environment. Maybe some shoes. We can make architecture. We can make buildings out of these mushrooms maybe in the future. We find a way to reinforce the material. And the people are actively doing that. There's a startup that Isaac and I work with in San Francisco that they're called MicroWorks. And they are making materials out of mushrooms.
There's a student in the dorm who works there, by the way.
What's that?
A student in the dorm who works there.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Excellent. Yeah. Excellent. Yeah, yeah. So, yeah. What's her name?
Elizabeth.
Okay, great. Yeah. Glad to hear, because it's important work. Because we think about the future, a future where we might wish for things to be degradable and sustainable and holistic solutions. What can we make with mushrooms? What is possible from here on the Earth and beyond? Maybe you can make, what parts of this space station could you make out of mushroom? I'm hoping that we can develop technologies that make the whole thing out of mushrooms, all the way down to the electronics. We just grow it with bacteria. They would grow and make wires and just grow. We would program the DNA. That's the beauty of biology, is that you could just encode in the genome the form and shape that it takes later at some time, across length scales, across time scales. And when biology is anything's possible. Everything you see here is made out of mushroom. From the dress, to the table, to the chairs, 3D printed, and then inoculated with mushrooms, so they 3D print some cellular structure, and then inoculate with a mushroom, and the mushroom grows through it, fills up the structure. That's cool, but that's not what I want to get to, because then you still have to predetermine the form, right? But the thing about biology, if you take a seed and you plant the seed, it grows into a tree. The tree, that form, that shape is already programmed into it. Yeah, there are stimulus from the environment that give it some uniqueness to it, but that form, us, you know, how do we know, why isn't one of my arms much, much longer? Yeah, maybe one of my arms is longer than the other, but there's like feedback there, and it's all programmed into my DNA. And look at those shoes, like I wish I had these. These are awesome. And it's all good, but we have to remind ourselves that the future is not certain. And we have to be stewards, we have to be vigilant. And it's a big task, but we have to do it together.
Evolutionary theory as to how those mini cells evolve, what's their purpose?
That's a great question. So it's I don't know. What we think is this mutation, we're not sure if it confers some advantage. I don't know much more than that. Okay. We don't know much more than it's a mutation that causes this to happen. People noticed it way back when, and much like a lot of other things in biology. As soon as people understood that these biotechnologies could be applied to human health, a lot of this other biology stuff that happened in E. coli and other ecology was just left behind. And they stopped doing research on them. So presumably some researcher isolated that mutant a long time ago, noticed that it was happening, and then isolated it. We're not sure if it confers some advantage in the wild.
Thank you.
Yeah, I have a question. What fascinates me as a civil engineer is this using mushrooms to build things. I know we've talked about this in the past. There's already a precedent for that, like trees and wood, right? Like it's biology that we use to create things. Why is it that you think like this has so much more promise than that? I mean, trees take a long time to grow. Is this, like, what's the advantage of using mushrooms?
I think you're great, right? And I've thought about this recently, like wood is still stronger than this mushroom material, right? And it's because of the microstructure, it's more regular. You have cells in wood, and those regularities confer like a macro strength to it, whereas this like irregular microstructure of the mycelia gives it some material properties like buoyancy and lightness. But what I like about it is that for wood, we have to grow the tree, we have to have land and feed the trees, and then they grow and we cut them down and we shape them. There's a lot of waste involved in that. Whereas the mushroom material, we could take garbage and feed it to the mushroom and make things out of the garbage. You could take agricultural ways. I come from Salinas. You would see when there was a crop that went bad, it would just go bad, and it would go bad in the field. And what was good is that people learned that you could retill that, but not all the stuff, right? So you had to take some stuff out of it, out of there, and you would just take it to a dump, in a landfill, and compost it, which is good. You make fertilizer, for sure. But I think there's an alternative that you can do now, given these technologies, take some of those wastes and make now materials out of it. And so you close the loop on your economy, make it a circular economy. For sure, wood will be a part of our system going forward. I doubt that it'll ever be replaced. Wood has its form, has its shape, has its aesthetic pleasing things about it. But I think what I would like to see is a future where things aren't wasted, and we can make the most out of what we have and have greater efficiency by doing things like this.
What are your thoughts on maybe, so when you said that you can kind of encode something in the mushrooms and then that they'll just grow and they'll do their thing, do you think that whoever could have a hand and maybe there's a mistake and you start having this mushroom that grows uncontrollably and it just kind of devours some crops that we really need? And, or where do you think it could go wrong?
So can something go wrong? Absolutely. As I said, I don't know of one thing where it's fail-safe, right? We could look at the dam up in Oroville right now. They engineered that dam to be like three. They engineered some stuff and they thought about some constraints. They're like, there's a flood that happens, this big flood comes, let's make it three times as strong, right? And look at the dam today. I mean, the way that we've engineered things. We engineer things to have constraints, and there's risk involved in everything. And we try to mitigate that risk with technology, with normative culture. One of the things that so bio accidents, they will happen, and we would like to mitigate those things, and that's why it's that much more important to engage and infer. And that, it's not just enough to educate the public or outreach to the public. You have to enfranchise people. So people should be like using this stuff and involved in this stuff, in order to mitigate some of those and think about those things and work on those things. And so things like bio error, bio accidents, those things will happen. And that's a great point, because a lot of times people will jump to right away like bio terror or bio like something like people using this for bad. And you just haven't seen that. It's been possible for, as you've seen, for the past four decades, people have been able to work with these technologies. And no one's done it. It's because, I suspect, because like it's hard to pinpoint. You can't really, maybe someday you will be able to, but you can't really direct a biological warfare agent to only attack your enemy. If you release it, it attacks you and your enemy. So that's one of the reasons that we probably haven't seen those kinds of things happen. You're right. And there are those things that we have to think about, those things, and we should be cautious.
So you have that example about the, I think they had like this dome, I guess, and there was styrofoam that they wanted the mycelium or like the mushrooms to break down. So can you talk about like the current research in the field and like what have been like the caveats or like drawbacks to those experiments? And then also, like, how can you be sure that once they break down the material, it doesn't degrade into toxic waste?
Yeah. So you're talking about that one up in the right?
Oh, I think there was like another example. You said like I think it was like a European thing, right? Yeah.
Yeah, that one. Oh, okay, yeah, that one. So this is to my dismay, that thing does not exist. It was just like a mock-up art thing that they did.
Oh, okay.
But the idea is sound. We have someone, Isaac here, is working on the fungi as well, trying to get it in with the idea of getting it to eat plastic. So we wouldn't want to just feed it. Agriculture, we'd want to feed it plastic. Our ocean is full of plastic. You go to the, I mean, I'm a surfer, so I go down to Manresa Beach or over in Santa Cruz. You see things that are dead on the ground, and they're just full of plastic. It's like what is that? Like, why? That's unacceptable. But not to say that you want to release a mushroom that is then going to go cause some other problems here, when you have this intention of doing something good, right? Some of the challenges right now, these things are so complex that we're just really just kind of scratching the surface right now. For instance, if I want to, people have isolated fungi that do feed on plastic, that can break down plastic, can eat the plastic. So one way that we're thinking of incorporating that is looking at what that the genes that that fungus uses, the enzymes that it secretes, and then trying to port those genes over to our fungus, and then have it secrete those enzymes to see if it can eat the plastic. And this is all in the lab, right? And we'll take precautions necessary to make sure that we don't, as much as possible, prevent that kind of a release of these engineered organisms before we know whether or not before we've been able to test them to see if they're safe for field employment. I guess some of the challenges are going to be like having a standard input. Like if what biology is awesome because it's resilient, it can like take on different environments and adapt to them and stuff. We'd like to incorporate that into our engineering, but right now our mindset is like a reductionist. Classically, historically, engineering and science has been this like reductionist thing, or this like this thing where you just try to compartmentalize stuff. Biology doesn't work that way, so it's a new way of thinking. It's a new way of engineering. That's why we, as much as we want to intervene and shape and guide or shape the biology, we have to learn from it as well. I mean, there's all kinds of fields about like biomimicry. People trying to understand search algorithms from swarms and from fungi as well. How do they find food, and what are the algorithms that they use, and applying those into computer science and stuff as well.
I really appreciate how you started off talking about your community and where you came from, and I'm wondering, what do you think the single most important contribution bioengineering could make to your communities in the next 10 years or something like that? Like, if you could just choose one invention, what do you think that would be?
So in Salinas, there's a community called My Community College. They're training people to be laborers, which is great. Like, there are jobs that need to be filled. For instance, respiratory therapists. They have a program that they just implemented in the community college for respiratory therapists. It's awesome, right? We've got two hospitals in Salinas. So if you say two hospitals, two shifts per hospital, and say two people per shift, you're going to hit that quota of necessary people to fill those positions right away. But yet they just built out a new program for that. And that was like really disheartening to me, because I've been going, like, since I left that school, I've gone back every year, multiple times a year. I go back there, talk to people. I give lectures, I give talks, I sit on panels. I talk to the administrators. I've been trying to get them to understand what's coming, what are the things that they can do to try to employ people, not to have their checks signed. Maybe the side checks, I don't know. If we're operating within the constraint of this system that we have, this economic system, right? We're operating within it. And I don't have illusions of breaking the system or completely turning the system over in the next 5 years. So I'm trying to operate within that. And what I would want plain and simply is a biotech training program that gets people up to speed on biology and the cutting edge technologies, because I don't think you need to do a PhD to understand enough to be able to make and build and produce with this technology. And so I'd like to see people opening up shops that that look like microbreweries, but they're producing, you know, pharmaceuticals, or look like microbreweries and they're producing bioinoculants, organic fertilizers, things like that, so that you can change the power dynamic. You know, I went to a panel. The mayor was like, "When you're in public office, you have no power. You're of service. You're of service to the community," and that was really enlightening to me, because that's true, right? If you're the mayor, you're just of service. Okay, and it depends on who your community is, right? And if your community is like the status quo, very rich billionaires that are growing stuff, you're gonna listen to them. And if they say, well, you know, we've got all this labor that now can't come back into the country because there's a wall and everybody's kicked out, well, we need robots, right? Now let's put a tax on the ballot, or let's put an initiative on the ballot to fund a robot like initiative or something. Cool, but then that leaves a bunch of people out of work, right? And then what if you're training people to be respiratory therapists, and respiratory therapy is now taken over by artificial intelligence? All those people that went through your program are going to be out of a job. And so teaching people how to work with machines, to do things like this, to do things that are more creative, those are the kinds of things that I hope would be applied, and that you can make a direct impact.
So I once saw a TED Talk where they were actually using some type of mushroom to create some type of styrofoam. They were, in that case, obviously kind of shaping it, not the types of DNA, but where else do you think that mushrooms could be applied to replace some type of plastic, or so to imitate that type of plastic that we use more in daily life?
So, everything. Everything is made of petroleum.
So in the near future, what do you think, just based on where research is right now, what type of plastic would be the one that we're most likely and more easily
I see your question. Stuff like, so things that aren't so structural, mm-hmm. You could have plastics that are very high density plastics that are very strong that you use for like glass, right? I don't think those are going to be replaced by mushroom technologies soon. But things like packaging, much of the stuff that we, like fibers, stuff like tables and stuff, I think you can do. That company, there's a company at East Coast called Ecovative, and they've got the market right now on like on packaging. So they're doing all kinds of different boxing, packaging, filling, stuff like that. The little filling plastic, like foamy things that you fill boxes with, they're trying to get there as well. And what they do is they grow these things, they grow them up in the forms and the shapes, and they basically bake them, and that kills the mushroom, stops it from growing. Excuse me, and then they sell it. But eventually, I'd want to replace every. I don't want to drill out of the ground. Like, that is stupid for us to be doing. We drill out of the ground and we burn things, and they go back to atmosphere, and it's not sequestered. I'm okay with burning things. Like, we can burn things for fuel. Liquid fuels are high. They're good. They're useful to us because they're high density, right? You get a lot of bang for your buck. But that has to be offset. Like, you have to be sucking more CO2 and greenhouse gases out of the atmosphere if you're gonna do that. That's the only way, I think. I think you had a question?
I guess for your community and SLNS, do you already have like a curriculum like sort of put together?
So I started down that path like when I first got here, but it turned out to be. So I see my role, like today there was a big strike, right? There was a big immigration strike. And yet I'm here. Yet I went to the lab. Not to say that I don't believe in that or support that, but we have roles. And I think my role right now is to learn as much as I can so that I can then empower people and enfranchise people. That's my role, that's my job. And I take that very seriously. So I had to put that, it's still there, I had to put that on the back order. There are curriculums already, like Ohlone College has a biotech training program, but they train people specifically for like health
sector, so you learn all the basic wet lab skills, but it's very much like, okay, this is how you grow human cells for protein production or different stuff like that. This is different. Biomanufacturing this way, this scale, thinking like this is different from what's been going on, but people are getting there.
I'm just curious, what is your day-to-day life in the lab, like what you do in the lab to help out with this research?
It's so awesome. Like I get to work with robots, high performance computers, and like super awesome cutting edge microscopes in biology and wetware. I go into the lab in the morning, I'll do some stuff, tinker, I'll check on my, you know, it's like I have pets, so I'll check on my mushrooms, and then I'll come back into my office, and I've got like two screens, big wide screens, I've got a powerful computer with a desk that goes up and down, like I couldn't ask for more, right? And I'm like on the internet, like chatting with people around the world, like I'm so privileged, and I, that's why, you know, I feel this responsibility, because it's important that I recognize it, how privileged I am, and then do what I need to do to fulfill my responsibility.
My question is that what's the advantage of this sort of biotechnology compared with all of the traditional and technologies like material science or electronics? And for example, let's take this mushroom-based research as an example. You have showed that we can get nearly everything, like a table, a chair, or a shoe, a pair of shoes from the mushroom. But if we look at exactly the chemistry of the mushroom, of a plant, it is actually based on carbon. We cannot begin from the genetic engineering to grow a silicon-based plant. It's impossible. Most of this is carbon, and also most of this is water, and the rest is carbon.
Yeah.
And you cannot grow a mushroom that is stronger than the metal, and you can't grow a mushroom which is more flexible than polymer. And the another aspect is that you said that another aim is to recycle the plastic waste, but there are many methods in material science that we can recycle the plastic, or we can just melt it and using like 3D printing to use the melted polymer to print anything.
Yeah.
And what's the advantage of this technology?
Yeah. So the first thing, my advisor's goal, what he likes to say is that he likes to hold up a cell phone. And I think there's a class, Bio-E 40A or 44 or something, where the students, they'll take a mold, they'll take sawdust, and then they'll make a mold, and they'll grow a cell phone case out of mushroom. Well, my advisor, what he likes to say is he likes to hold up the phone and says that he'd like to grow a cell phone out of mushroom. And in our lab, someone was working on a project that used bacteria to assemble silicon nanoparticles. And so you can make a biofilm that would be covered in silicon. And if you imagine, I do this now to engineer to introduce DNA into the fungi. I grow bacteria and fungus together. If you imagine then a future, which I think is possible, and there are groups that engineered de novo, engineered proteins that did not exist in nature, that now assemble silicon and will make silicon carbon bonds. And so, to your point that you can't make silicon things with biology, I would say that you can, and that you will increasingly be able to, so that someday you will be able to make, you will grow a cell phone. Instead of subtractive manufacturing, you'll grow things, additive manufacturing as you grow. And so, to your other point, like polymers and things like that, biopolymers are abundant. One of the most abundant biopolymers on the planet is chitin. And that's what this fungi uses, why it gives it some of the structural properties that we can shape bricks out of it. We're working to develop the mushroom technology such that it will produce more chitin, so the materials will be stronger and more durable, and yet light and flexible. So you can get some of these things, some of these advantages. The main advantage, one of the main advantages is that it's a biology is a distributed nanotechnology. It's a programmable distributed nanotechnology. The proteins inside of a cell are just nano machines, and they work at the atomic scale. So they literally will take an atom of silicon and an atom of carbon and put that together. And I don't know that if there's any efficiencies right now, material science, there's any technology material science that allows us to do that at scale. We can do some of that in the lab, but it's not at scale. And we can't program it the way that we can program biology. But that doesn't mean that you'll do away with 40, 50, 60, 70 years of and beyond years of experience and technology. No, this is coming together to do things better in the future, I think. And your other question, oh, sorry.
Is that you mentioned the recyclability of this technology. So what's the advantage compared with 3D printing? We can just collect the plastic and melt it together and use 3D printing to print.
Sure. But again, if that's great, that technology should be developed. It should be around. I don't think it's a this or that. I think it's this and that together, right? If we can take plastic and recycle it to make more plastic, then someday we decide that plastic is better suited as food, and we feed it to our fungus and we eat it. I think that they're complementary.
All right, thanks so much, Rolando.
I'm sure you guys want to like.